Operational calculus is the algebraic study of calculus operators, closely related to the operational approach to umbral calculus we saw in the first video. We'll be referring back to a lot of the material from that first video, so I strongly recommend you check that out first. This video will also be a little more difficult. I'm going to assume you are comfortable with some basic differential equations and Taylor series. And, as you might have guessed, again, we'll be using operator notation. We'll start off by just talking a bit about numbers and arithmetic, shifting our perspective a little, in such a way as to get a better understanding of linear operators. This will propel us into a discussion of differential equations, recurrence relations, exponential shift, and more. I think this one's going to be fun. So we can think about numbers in a couple different ways. Perhaps the most common is as points on a line, with rules on how we can combine them using addition or multiplication. Alternatively, instead of a point, we could think of a number as being a transformation, a shift or stretch of the whole line. For instance, the number 2 could be thought of as this point, and it interacts with other points based on the rules of multiplication and addition, which are called operations and are separate objects. On the other hand, the notion, the process of adding 2, can be seen as the translation that maps 0 onto this point. And the notion of multiplying by 2 is the stretch that maps 1 onto this point. So we can think of a product like 2 times 3 equals 6 in 4 different ways. The first, 2 and 3 are objects, points, and they can be combined using this extraneous notion of multiplication to produce another point, 6. The second, 2 is a point, and the transformation times 3 is acting on that point to send it to a new point, 6. The third, 3 is a point, and the transformation times 2 is acting on that point to send it to a new point, 6. And lastly, times 2 and times 3 are both transformations, which, when composed, result in another transformation, times 6. For the rest of this video, when we're thinking about a number specifically as being a transformation, we'll paint it red. This isn't technically necessary, after all you could argue that the points on the line are simply representations of the corresponding transformations, but, well, we're just getting our feet wet, I think it's important to keep the distinction crystal clear and in the front of our minds. In particular, we're going to insist that these transformations are acting on functions, that is, for our purposes today, they're operators. And more than that, we know they're additive, and they commute with scale multiplication. So these things we have in red are linear operators. Let's look again at our example. 2 times 3 equals 6 is fine, obviously we can write it like this. But what this equation is really evoking is that the 2 operator, composed with 3 operator, and then applied to some function f, is equal to that function under the action of the 6 operator. Similarly, when written in red, the equation 2 plus 3 equals 5 means that the 2 operator of f plus the 3 operator of f equals the 5 operator of f. Maybe you can already see where we're going with this. It doesn't immediately make much sense to, say, add 1 to the differential operator, but we know perfectly well that we can add 2 linear operators together. The main intuition I want to give you is this. In a context like this, operators, where the things we're studying are the transformations, when diagrams like these come to mind, we'd like to be thinking about only the arrows, without getting them confused with the objects between them. Let's look at the differential operator more closely under this line. Since it's linear, we know it commutes with scalar multiplication. And it's additive. In other words, it distributes over addition. And notice that in this case, a and b don't have to be scalars. These could all be any linear operators. This is already kind of fascinating, don't you think? It means, given an expression like this, we can apply the distributive property a couple times to expand it. In other words, given a second-order linear differential equation that looks like this, we can just factor it into two much simpler problems, which we can solve and combine with superposition. And yeah, for differential equations of any order, we can talk about them using these purely algebraic manipulations. It's about time we introduce a new linear operator. The unit shift, or translation operator, denoted by t, is the linear operator that maps f of x to f of x plus 1. Its inverse is just a shift in the other direction, and applying t n times results in a shift of n units. Notice how we can express the forward difference in terms of t, delta equals t minus 1. It's also worth mentioning that just like how phi gave us the Stirling numbers as coefficients, t is the operator that gives us the binomial coefficients. Just like how we can use d to solve differential equations, we can use delta to solve difference equations, and we can use t to solve recurrence relations. To see this in action, let's look at how we can solve a recurrence relation like a differential equation. First, take the first order equation t equals a, where a is an arbitrary constant. Whatever the zeroth term happens to be, we know f of 1 will be a times that constant. Similarly, f of 2 will be a squared times f of 0, and so on. So the general form of f of x is a to the x times some arbitrary constant. Now, recall that the Fibonacci sequence is defined like this. Each term is the sum of the previous two. 0 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, and so on, which we can express in terms of t like so. Factoring, the roots of this quadratic are 1 plus or minus the square root of 5 over 2, which you may recognize as the golden ratio and its conjugate. So, using the same superposition principle we'd use for a differential equation, we find that f of x is equal to k1 times the golden ratio to the x, plus k2 times the conjugate golden ratio to the x, where the k's are constants. Just like for differential equations, we can determine these constants by looking at the initial conditions. F of 0 equals 0, so we know one is just the negative of the other. And f of 1 equals 1, giving us this equation, which boils down to 1 over the square root of 5. And, just like that, we were able to use our calculus knowledge to find a closed form for the Fibonacci numbers. This is known as Binet's formula, and if you write it out in full, it looks like this. Let's see an example where the right side isn't just zero. We'll express this as an operator, of course. Just remember this d is differentiation with respect to x. This time we actually have to address the elephant in the room. How do we go about finding the inverse of something like 1 minus d? The trick is to notice the product rule can give us something that looks like this. In particular, the d of e to the minus x times y is given by e to the minus x times dy plus y times d e to the minus x, which is just minus e to the minus x. Make e to the minus x dy the subject, and we see that after multiplying through by e to the minus x, we can substitute this in up here. These two terms cancel out, And boom, we've transformed the operator into something we know how to invert. Namely, we can integrate by parts. And again. And again. And finally, multiply through by e to the x for the solution. So we can shift a differential equation to make it easier to solve by multiplying through by an exponential. This is a special case of the exponential shift theorem. Operational calculus offers an alternative method for problems like this, which is both much quicker and much weirder. Are you ready? We divide through by 1 minus d. Then just formally expand this as a geometric series. Add on the complementary function, and we're done. Isn't that beautiful? It turns out that playing with operators in series expansions does tend to yield meaningful results in general. Recall the Taylor series for a general function at an arbitrary point A. Remember here that d is still differentiation with respect to x applied to f. The only difference is now we're evaluating whatever that happens to be at the value a. Notice what we have here on the left is a shift of x units applied to f of a. And the sum on the right, as you may recognize, is the series we get if we formally expand e to the x d. So, just like how exponentiating a complex number, a plus bi, corresponds to the composition of a stretch action and an orthogonal rotation action, if we exponentiate a plus bd, we get the composition of a scalar stretch and an orthogonal shifting action. This finds use in describing iterated functions, which we'll talk about in its own dedicated video. So we've already seen that delta equals t minus 1. Now we can also express it in terms of d like this. Consider another new linear operator, b, that amounts to differentiating the summation formula of a function. Formally rearranging for d, we can sub this in here. And again, formally expand as a power series. Applying b to monomials gives us the Bernoulli polynomials, which are pretty mysterious and important, appearing in some really deep bits of maths like the Riemann zeta function and Faulhaber's formula. I'll be making a full video on this as well. These days, operational calculus has all but been replaced by more modern techniques like Laplace transforms. Nonetheless, despite its lack of rigor, it remains a powerful device for understanding and reasoning about these kinds of problems. So, in the spirit of Heaviside, developing the theory in the 1880s, I encourage you to just have fun messing around with this stuff and see what kinds of mysteries you can uncover. Thanks for watching! I'll be starting some other exciting side projects alongside continuing this abstract calculus series, so stay tuned for that. I've also set up a Discord server and a Patreon page, links in the description. Check it out if you'd like to get more involved with the channel or just want to hang out with like-minded people.